Here and you did this. Now we're in the midst of a generation that yet lift their hands in the air and do this. We find ourselves at a crossroads of history between crisis and controversy. Yes, sir. We find ourselves in the midst of an agonizing hour, an extraordinary moment in which the character of our nation is being tested. Yes. We find ourselves as a citizenry reading our newspapers, scanning our mobile devices, listening to the radio, and being subjected to a seemingly unending stream of criminal justice tragedies. Okay. We find ourselves in the midst of tragedies, in the midst of a stream of hashtags that leave our children with morally confused and ethically befuddled faces. We find ourselves in a moment when we hear the names Trayvon Martin, Eric Garner, Michael Brown, Sandra Bland. We find ourselves at a moment when we hear names, but these are not names of anonymity. These are the names of our children, the names of our citizens, the names of our brothers and sisters, and yea, even the names of the children of God. We find ourselves at an agonizing moment in American history. We're reminded of an extraordinary historic church that stands with a stately grace in a holy city called Charleston, South Carolina. A church called Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church. We're reminded of an hour on a Wednesday evening when a stranger who was handed a Bible extended the right hand of fellowship, who sat down thereafter, put down his Bible, and slew 9 students of scripture in the house of God. We find ourselves at an agonizing hour. And yet I'm reminded of a people who look deep within themselves and yet declared these words: wrong church, wrong people, wrong time. That congregation of Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church said, wrong church, wrong people, wrong time. Here we are this evening, Catholics and Protestants, Jews and Gentiles, Baptists and Methodists, people of every hue and every heritage, from every walk of life, and we yet say, right people, right time, because we're standing at the crossroads of history, and at the crossroads of change, and at the crossroads of a moment in which we are going to remake and redeem and claim this American country. It's a moment in which we're reminded that our lives, our votes, our jobs, and our schools matter.
Yes.
We're reminded by the day that African-American men are 21 times more likely to lose their lives at the hands of the police than their white counterparts. We're reminded that 1 out of every 4 African-American men reports being racially profiled in a given month. We're reminded that this problem is not one merely of race or of a particular or singular gender, but it is a problem that afflicts people on the basis of religion, on the basis of sexual orientation, on the basis of ethnicity. Our report, Born Suspect, says that they're Muslims being racially profiled, they're black women being racially profiled, they're gays and lesbians being racially profiled, they're American citizens being racially profiled. We're reminded that this is a flesh and blood obscenity that runs counter to our highest moral and constitutional values. We're reminded that this is not who we are as a country. No. It's our, we're reminded, our foremothers and forefathers, our forebears did not allow President Lyndon Baines Johnson to sign into the law the Voting Rights Act merely with the ink of a president's pen. We signed that legislation into law with the blood, sweat, and tears of martyrs on blood-stained highways and tear-streaked byways. We signed that legislation into law with our sacrifice, with our commitment. We yet breathe the breath of life into a dry piece of parchment called the U.S. Constitution. With a moment, this very moment, our country is filled with people who have full-time aspirations, full-time ambitions, who are yet relegated to part-time pay. We're reminded of a beautiful people, a hard-working people, a dreaming people, an aspiring people, people who came to this country on ships and slave ships. Yeah. Their descendants stand in the streets, crying for work, demanding jobs and a living wage, because they understand all too well that jobs are not merely about dollars, but about dignity. Not merely about net worth, but self-worth. We're reminded that in this very hour, income inequality is such that the distance between the rich and poor is as great as it was in 1928. We're reminded this very hour that there are children whose bodies are wrapped in beautiful black and brown skin.
Come on.
And whose intellect is infused with brilliance. And yet they are relegated as first-class citizens in the kingdom of God to third-class schools in this country. We're reminded that at this very hour, our children are being condemned. Our children are being damned. Our children are being indicted.
Yes, sir.
By racism in our midst.
Yes.
We're reminded that we as an American people find ourselves standing on opposite sides of a divide of distrust. Racism, anti-Semitism, sexism, bigotry, and bias standing between us.
Yes, sir.
But I say to you that on this very day, in this very hour, there is the Spirit of God calling out to his people to yay, be one people, to stand together, to fight together, to love together, to march together, and yay, claim and redeem this nation together. We have a generation of our young people who watch the majority of police officers walk by wearing brass badges,
come on. We pay for
blue uniforms.
We pay for
the overwhelming majority honoring their oaths, honoring their badges.
Come on.
But a slim and misguided and occasionally, and more than occasionally, evil minority have caused them to yet wonder whether Kendrick Lamar is right when he says, do you hear me?
Do you hear
me? Do you feel me? We gonna be all right.
Yes.
All right. Yeah. So here we stand today, at this moment, faced with an agonizing choice. We can lie down and capitulate to the gradualism of evil in our society, or we can yet fall on our knees that we might rise on our feet and stand against injustice, stand against bigotry, stand against racism, stand against sexism, stand against anti-Semitism, and stand, 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 stand for our country. than those who are asking the question alive.
Mm-hmm.
Why America's journey for justice?
Yes.
We yet say to you that we as citizens of this republic have determined within ourselves to march 867 miles across the length and breadth of our democracy, across five states, three purple states, two red states, and into one blue district of Columbia, because we understand united we stand and divided we fall.
Yes.
We have determined within ourselves to march in 104 degree heat. We have determined to sleep in church basements and synagogues and Islamic temples. We have decided and determined within ourselves to sacrifice ourselves because we understand that we love each other. We will hold on to each other and we will fight for one another. So we're marching from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C., and we're going to march by the thousands, by the thousands, by the thousands across the 14th Street Bridge and into the halls of Congress. We're marching.
Marching.
Because we believe that our lives, our votes, our jobs, and our schools matter. We're marching because we're standing for specific pieces of legislation to end racial profiling, to restore the Voting Rights Act, to ensure that people have access to living jobs at living wages, and to ensure that our schools are equitably and equally funded. We have decided and determined within ourselves to not just march, but march to demonstrate to educate, and educate to legislate. The story is told in a slim book of the Bible entitled Esther.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. About a young Jewish sister named Esther Hadassah.
Yes.
Who came into a position of relative privilege and relative power.
Come on.
And there was an evil man by the name of Haman, who had a homicidal hatred of Mordecai. And he lifted this homicidal hatred of a man by the name of Mordecai and extended it into a genocidal assault against the Jewish people. And yet even today, in the midst of this American democracy, where so many of our young people yet believe that they are in the midst of a pandemic of police misconduct, they yet feel as though they are under assault.
Yeah.
The story tells us that Mordecai went to Esther's side and asked her a question. Who knows?
Who knows? All right.
Who knows?
Who knows?
That you come to this royal position for such a time as this? Who knows that we've come to this King Center for such a time as this? Who knows that we have decided to walk to Washington, D.C. for such a time as this? Who knows that we are yet here today for such a time as this? If by chance we've come empowered with a prophetic spirit.
Come on.
Empowered with the spirit of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Empowered with the spirit of Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. Empowered by the spirit of Sojourner Truth. Empowered by the spirit of Malcolm X.
Come on, Father.
Empowered by the spirit of Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Amos. Empowered by the by such a spirit, we're going to walk day in and day out.
Yes.
We're not going to give up. We're not going to give in. We're not going to give over. We're not going to grow discouraged. We're not going to grow dismayed. And even if we do,
come on,
we'll recall that hymn of the NAACP. Days of liberty, let our rejoicing rise. Hearts of listening skies, let it resound loud as a rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dog has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. facing the rising sun of our new day begun. Let